tuning into Liberty Under Attack Radio, your home for libertarianism in action. We provide you with real free market solutions using the freedom umbrella of direct action to give you the tools necessary to increase your own personal liberty. As Ludwig von Mises said, liberty is always freedom from the government. And now your host, Shane.
And welcome to Liberty Under Attack Radio, your home for anarchism and action. We're certainly glad you've decided to join us. I'm your host, Shane, coming to you from the communist state of Illinois, Bloomington to be exact. Liberty Under Attack is covered by a BIPCOT no government license. This allows reuse and modification by anyone except, big except, for governments and the agents thereof. You can learn more at BIPCOT.org. I have two quick updates for you and then one more important production note. First off, as I have been promoting, the full 40-plus hour direct action series is now free. If you're an individual looking for non-political ways to find freedom now without asking for permission, the DAS is for you. Just visit libertyunderattack.com/freedom now to get your copy today. Also, the second edition of the Vonnie podcast was released this past Tuesday. If you're a normal listener to this show, you're going to want to check out the Vonnie podcast. Just visit vonniepodcast.com or search for the Vonnie podcast on your favorite podcatcher to subscribe today. As of right now, it's iTunes, Stitcher, and Google Play. Still waiting on TuneIn Radio. They're being a little slow for some odd reason. Not quite sure, but there's definitely plenty of outlets where you can pick up, where you can subscribe to the Vonnie podcast. And now for the more major update. As you probably know, for the past 2 years, I've been attending higher-level indoctrination college and have despised it. Hell, there's an entire series on Adventures in Illinois Higher Education. My major was journalism with a minor in philosophy, but a couple of months ago, I did some intense pondering about my future. The only jobs available with those degrees are working for mainstream media, really. In philosophy, there's no, unless I'm going to be a professor, which that's not going to happen, there's really no way to apply a philosophy degree today. pretty much a waste of time. But in regards to, you know, the journalism one, I mean, sure, there could be some work in the alternative media, but the magic piece of paper isn't necessary for that. So yeah, I mean, I'd struggle finding ways to make ends meet with my current trajectory. Now, I've always been interested in the trades, you know, electrician work, HVAC, you know, heating and air, etc. And what's even better about those career paths is that often you can get paid for your training while in school, and the certifications are much easier to obtain in regards to the time spent. Now, obviously, there's, you know, some learning in those fields, but yeah, the time, definitely a lot lower than, you know, spending 4, 6, or 8 years in higher-level indoctrination, accumulating massive amount of debt. And they're actually, like, real skills that you can use in everyday life. I mean, whether it's welding, electrician work, or HVAC, I mean, these are actually real tangible skills. Once I get learned, as Ricky from the Trailer Park Boys would call it, I can actually, you know, go and use my hands to do these things. Whereas, I mean, with what I was learning for journalism, I mean, you've seen the all of the fake news stuff. I mean, that's not journalism. That's not journalism at all. And the mainstream media outlets, I couldn't survive working there. I really couldn't. So as far as what you're learning in journalism, journalism major, you really aren't applying your craft in a productive way that promotes freedom or anything, any nonsensical notion like that. And unlike college, I mean, With these trades, I mean, it wouldn't feel like a huge money and time dump. You know, going to school, I had the hardest time, trying to find a job. And the only time when I was, there at the Illinois State University campus where I didn't feel like I was wasting my time was, you know, in between classes or when I'd go an hour early to class to, you know, read Human Action by Ludwig von Mises. That was the only time I really felt like it wasn't wasted. And then obviously, you know, the community college in the first semester at ISU where, you know, there was quite a few articles coming out for the Adventures in Illinois Higher Education series. But other than that, I mean, it was just a huge time dump with nothing really tangible to come out of it. And I'm sure you can kind of understand my frustration, but I mean, there's a light at the end of the tunnel here. There is a light at the end of the tunnel. So I finally found a full-time job, and I'll be living extremely frugally. I mean, I already have kind of had to, you know. Going to college and not being able to find a job, it's been tough, and I've been living extremely frugally already. And, you know, I can extend that. I can extend that into, you know, actually, you know, starting off with saving 50% of my income and increasing that as I become, you know, more used to this. Because, yeah, the year I started LUA Radio in 2015, I had a really good job making, you know, quite a bit more money than what I am now. And I wasted so much money. And looking back on that, I mean, I could have been in a really, really good financial position if... a lot of variables and a lot of factors, but anyways, I've got a lot more knowledge now. I've gone through the direct action series, and I have been introduced to strategies like financially independent early retirement, you know, living frugally, and actually, you know, being able to put those things in motion, which is really, really, truly awesome. So part of that savings will obviously be for HVAC school in the fall, but obviously I'm working towards, you know, as I said, financially independent early retirement, where having a job becomes optional. Now that's still quite a ways out. It really is. I'm kind of starting from scratch here, but nonetheless, I'm kind of at the perfect age to get that started. I mean, I'll be turning 25, I think. Yeah. God, I'm already forgetting my age. I'll be 25 in May. be 25 in May, and you know, the financial independent early retirement folks say, you know, intensively save for, you know, 10 years, you're pretty much good to there's some other aspects as well, but this is just an introduction. This isn't you know, a discussion on financially independent early retirement, but yeah, they pretty much say, like, you know, 10-15 years and you can retire. So I mean, that still put me at like age 40 at the latest. So that's still pretty awesome to think about. But what does this mean for the podcast? I mean, I'm working that full-time job, and obviously got sort of kind of an outlook for the future. So what does it mean for the podcast? Well, I'm going back to releasing one LUA episode a week, and that'll be on Sundays. The recent episodes have tended to be longer, except for the introductory one to this Right to Travel series. But, and I mean, obviously, I do value your time after all. I mean, with what I'm currently doing, two LUA podcasts a week and one Vonnie podcast a week, I mean, that's a lot of your time. That really is. And I'm sure for some of you, it's hard to keep up with that. It really is. So I think, you know, ratcheting it back to one LUA podcast a week and one Vonnie podcast a week will even help you guys as well. Now I know some of you want that material, you know, three podcasts a week, but obviously that's still a lot of time to ask from you. And again, I do value your time. And I also definitely, you know, don't envision any slowdown in content. All I have to worry about is, you know, the 40 hours a week for the job, and I'll have at least a few hours every evening to work on content, as I'm kind of doing right now. There shouldn't be any conflict whatsoever, except for maybe the Patreon exclusives, but, you know, those are more tertiary, if anything. In closing, for the first time since I started college, I actually feel really positive about my future, and that's after I stopped going to college, and my stress level has also decreased significantly. There's actually kind of a path here. We talk about direct action pretty much constantly, and there's a lot of it to come from me in the next couple of years. I'm sincerely looking forward to sharing this journey with you. It's going to be a lot of fun. It's going to be a lot of fun, and I know I'm going to learn a lot, and hopefully you guys will, you know, learn from my experiences, whether they are, you know, good things or things not to do, whatever they may be. So moving forward, what do I have for you in this podcast? Well, since we're talking about direct action, the closing installment of my discussion with Kyle Rearden on his Right to Travel series will end with potential solutions on mitigating these infringements. Possible solutions include real-time ride-sharing like Uber, civilly defiant freedom cells, role-playing police interrogations, and much, much more. So without further ado, please enjoy my discussion with Kyle Rearden. I'll be back after to provide some closing thoughts. So, like I said, what I want to most talk about is, you know, we mentioned all these infringements and how, you know, totalitarian, authoritarian, and dangerous they are to, you know, freedom. So let's begin to talk about some solutions and, you know, combating or mitigating some of these laws and such. So, you know, in light of this lawfare that we've discussed, Kyle, I mean, what would you suggest to, you know, Right to Travel activists?
I would say that there's a lot of different approaches. I do think some work better than others. There is a question of efficacy. There's also, or effectiveness, there's also a question of personal preference. So let me just preface by saying this very quite simply. There is a market selection of libertarian resistance to the state. And some methods are riskier than others. Some things work better than others. And I think people should be at least initially open-minded enough to at least explore some of these things before making their judgments, whether for or against certain methods. And I would also suggest there is one thing, it's one thing to talk to the talk, but it's another thing to walk the walk. I'm more concerned with the walking portion, as it were. But as we're doing tonight, we have to do the talking part, at least to just even mention this to people. So please try to keep an open mind. And while I myself have come to certain conclusions about things, that doesn't necessarily have to mean you have to agree with me, but at least consider what I have to say and make your own judgments accordingly. And that being said, let's get into it.
Definitely.
I would say, well, I think the legal interstices are at least something to kind of like hover around. You know, again, some work better than others. You know, it's interesting. The legal interstice of against self-incrimination is something that's kind of like nascently there. But what's interesting is that it's not even really, in terms of actual practice, not legality, but reality, actual real practice, it's not even so much like filing paperwork or not filing paperwork or whatever. In many ways, Shane, a lot of security culture, which is what my last book was about, and you had me on before to discuss that, a lot of security culture was actually initially based off of the legal interstice against self-incrimination. And then, of course, it went far and beyond that to further develop really more practical methods like secured record archival and just a lot of other things. But for example, like keeping your own counsel and role-playing police interrogations, those two particular security culture methods were actually based off of trying to develop a practical way of implementing protections, realistic, not necessarily legal, but realistic protections against saying foolish things and basically incriminating yourself. So that's one thing, is basically learn how to deal with the police at these traffic stops where quite literally your life is in danger. Again, not a joke, not exaggerating, not doing satire here. This is grown-up adult time. Put on your big boy pants and big girl pants. Want to be fair to the finer, to the fairer sex, of course. It's this time to just realize this is make it or break it time, and there are serious consequences either way. So when I believe this was covered in previous episodes, but role-playing police interrogations would probably be the most important thing to start off with, just so that you don't end up in jail or dead or at the side of the road if they decide to impound your car but like leave you alone, because apparently that's happened to some people. So any combination of those really nasty consequences where you don't just, you know, travel off as you were before, so that, you know, you haven't lost anything, let me put it that way. If you're not the same way after the traffic stop that you were before, and now you're worse off, well, you know, obviously something wrong happened. And sometimes it's due to your own fault, mm-hmm. and sometimes not. But what we can do is try and teach people how to lower the risk. And that's why role-playing police interrogations as one security culture method is very valuable. But of course, I believe in ounce prevention is worth a pound of cure, which is why that other security culture method of using an inconspicuous car. So if you're not, so if you even just avoid, you just kind of glide right on by, they don't even notice you, you don't exist. They'll harass the guy with the Ferrari, or they'll harass the guy who's weeding in and out of traffic a lot, but they won't touch you because you're a ghost. You don't exist. You're virtually invisible because you blend into traffic and such. And there are ways to do that, that people can go look up at that article or even just the security culture book in general. But regarding right to travel, I would say if you can avoid and increase your or decrease the probability of even a traffic stop occurring in the first place, that would be one layer. But if you get pulled over, even if it's not due to your own fault, just other circumstances outside of your control, then that's where the role-playing police interrogations would come in handy, so that you don't say foolish things to put yourself in jail. So again, layers of security.
Indeed. And this is something I kind of heard from Brian Sovereign. And I kind of I didn't have like the evidence or anything like that. I just kind of assumed. But yeah, he mentioned, you know, to prevent further damage, do not use fingerprint unlock on phones because as far as entering your password, yes, that is protected by the Fourth Amendment. You don't have to do that. But if you have a thumbprint, they can force you to unlock your phone. So if there's anything incriminating on there that, you know, could, you know, further the investigation, yeah, you want to try to mitigate that as much as possible. And yeah, iPhones nowadays come with that. Maybe droids do, Androids. So, yeah, that's something you probably shouldn't use.
Well, yeah, I mean, one problem with cell phone, this is a little bit of a different topic, but I'll mention this in passing here. One of the problems of cell phone ownership is that the police really like to get their mitts on that. And unfortunately, I think I'll slightly disagree, but let's just kind of table it for the time being. I'll just say in passing that I'll somewhat disagree on the Fourth Amendment protections. When I wrote that other article on the cell phone ownership issues and if there were any legal protections, at least in terms of like the federal government or at least the federal judiciary ruling about what local cops can do, and so now there's a 14th Amendment issue on top of it, which then gets into a lot of legalisms I don't want to get into here. Suffice it to say, I couldn't find any legal protections. Different cases, different things, whether it was geolocation technology in the cell phones, whether it was people, even in some cases, using encryption or just other things. Every single time, it's like, nope, defendants can, you know, the search was legitimate, even though it was completely warrantless. I mean, just over and over and over again. Mm. Again, different topic for another time. However, in the context of right to travel, for those of you people who... there are some people who, and I do not encourage this for other reasons, but some people like to, say, drive without tags. If you're going to do that, maybe you shouldn't carry a cell phone on you because chances are you just increase your probability of having a traffic stop like up by a lot because you do stand out in the crowd because generally speaking, the privately owned automobiles, pretty much generally speaking, everybody's got, you know, tags because of the vehicle registration. And all that, because you are on a public highway, at least in some sense. So there are public road at the very least. So there's kind of a problem there. Now there was something interesting. I did mention this in the article and I did make a judgment about something, but perhaps I was wrong. So maybe as a bit of an addendum or whatever, maybe this would be best coming from you because you do know more about this, but regarding Uber, the real-time ride-sharing, I there was a sort of conclusion I did reach, but maybe you can explain maybe if I was off base or not. So I know people like it. The idea is that you contract out your ability to travel to someone else. You kind of offset. So instead of you traveling like behind the wheel and such, you have someone else who actually quite literally, I would assume, actually is a driver, literally. Or shall we say the old term being the chauffeur, perhaps. You pay him money, he moves you around basically on the public roads. And that's how he makes his livelihood, or at least as a part-time gig, like freelancing and such. So I guess the question is about the legality of all of that. What was it about that you think was going on there?
Yeah. And I did want to add, you mentioned that Uber is a gray market approach in your article, and obviously I disagree, and I'll mention that here in a moment, but and I know in one state, maybe it was New York City or something, some city that, you know, illegal, like made Uber illegal. There were still Uber drivers picking people up in those locations. So that would be gray market if, you know, the city made it illegal. But for, you know, 99% of, you know, the other Uber drivers, or 95%, whatever the percentage is, it's certainly white market. It requires a smartphone. It's all above board. You have to, I mean, to even use the app, you have to have a credit debit card in there. Taxes are taken out.
Ooh.
And you don't see Uber drivers being arrested. You don't see, you know, the founder CEOs being arrested, or whatever their titles are. They aren't being arrested. Like one of the cities, I think it might have been New York City, the gray market example that I provided before. But I mean, those cities are just shutting down, you know, a legal loophole, a legal interstice.
So hold on a minute. So hold on a minute. Are you seriously saying that all of the accusations I've been hearing from mainstream media, and hey, they've lied before too, right? I'm the guy who wrote the article on the media hoaxes, a different topic for another time. But are you seriously saying that the claims from the different authoritarians of various flavors, where they say that Uber is this unregulated company and we need like controls on and so forth, that that's not true, that there already are like controls and regulations and whatever else, which makes it white market?
Governments are having to, you know, catch up, and even at its inception, I mean, yeah, it may have been like a gray area, but it wasn't, you know, it wasn't, I don't think it was a gray market ever. I think it was just something, you know, something new that, you know, the state really didn't know, just the governments in general really hadn't seen anything like that before. They didn't have laws on the books for it. So what some cities are starting to do is, you know, to protect their taxi monopoly, for the taxi lobbyists, I mean, yeah, they're saying, we're going to go ahead and make this illegal. So that's kind of, you know, how I kind of understand it.
Okay, well, I guess I probably would stand corrected then. I seriously had thought that maybe the mainstream criticisms were correct, but I just agreed with the other side, right? Like, yeah, they shouldn't be regulated, right? You know, laissez-faire and all that. Okay, well, I guess I'll take that on the chin. I'll admit that. But yeah, I think what's important, you know, regardless of whether it's gray or white market or even sometimes black market, right, if it's a civil disobedience thing, right, where it's just straight up, because I think there were some municipalities in New Hampshire, I think, where Uber drivers can't operate. I remember seeing some reports.
That might have been the example that I was.
Yeah, remember, that would technically be more black market. If we're going by the agorist theory of the five markets, remember, black market's the illegal stuff, and the gray market is, well, it may or may not be. I mean, maybe it's legal, and, you know, there's the legal interstices, right? But then that's not 100% because, again, vague laws. Remember what James Madison said in the Federalist Papers about vague laws, that you don't really have to obey them, is what he was actually saying. And that is the position of the Patriot Movement, too, the minarchists. So, you know, it's just kind of like, I think the business model of what's called the real-time ride sharing, with the poster boy being Uber, but also including its competitors like Sidecar and Lyft, I love how they're competing against the monopolistic licensed taxi companies.
Oh, for sure. And I do think, even though it's not like there's no free market today. I mean, there's competition in some areas, but there's obviously a whole bunch of issues that we could get into with all of that. But it does demonstrate the efficacy of competition. I know I've used in Chicago when I was up there with my old co-host Danny and some other folks from the Midwest Peace and Liberty Coalition. We use Chicago to get everywhere. Because obviously we were getting hammered and partying, and it wouldn't be smart to drive. And obviously you really can't drive much in Chicago anyways. So yeah, we were using Uber the entire weekend, and I mean, within, you know, I think the longest we ever had to wait was like 10 or 15 minutes, and there was always a driver ready. And I think after the entire weekend, you know, you consider like two full days of like going back and forth and back and forth and back and forth. I think with between like three or four people, it came out to be like $70 total. So we just put, like, it was like, you know, $20 a person or whatever, give or take, for the entire weekend of, you know, moving around the city of Chicago. And then also, I used to live in a town called Downs, which is like 10-15 minutes outside of Bloomington. And I was out there at a family friend's house, you know, drinking, and I wanted to go home. And I said, we'll see if I can get an Uber out here. So the guy probably had to drive like, 10-15 minutes. And within 10-15 minutes, he was there, you know, at like midnight on a Friday night, or I guess Saturday morning, technically. Mm-hmm. He came and picked me up. And when you download Uber the first time, or you have a code or whatever, you get like $20 of free rides. So it would have cost like $10. It would have cost like $10. And I'm sure it would, I don't even know how much it would cost for a taxi, but $10 from there to my house. And it was very, very quick. So the competition aspect, yeah, you get definitely higher quality. And something, you know, getting taxis, which is something I noticed in Chicago, was, I mean, they have like water bottles in the back seat, they'll have snacks, the car is super clean. I mean, they want to make sure your ride is extremely enjoyable. So I don't know. I like Uber. I definitely like Uber. I've got both the apps on my phone for whenever I do need to use them. But I like the services, but there definitely are some drawbacks, such as, you know, the privacy and the geolocation, because that's kind of a necessity. You put in your location and the driver comes and gets you, and then also the taxes too. So
all right, so just to be clear, before we look at some of the other, you know, some other things that people have proposed regarding how to actually successfully handle and exercise one's right to travel or freedom of movement, as you prefer. So Uber would be, so if I understand this, just to be clear, and I want to make this crystal, crystal clear for the audience, because I believe much of the audience likes Uber and those similar things as well. Uber is, you're saying it is a white market type of activity, largely because there is no privacy, there can't be. There's no end-to-end encryption between the customers and the drivers, of course. And the drivers do pay taxes.
Well, yeah, it's legal employment. Yeah, I mean, it's legal on the books.
So, okay, let me just do a little bit of commentary here. So let me understand. In terms of, like, the money flow the drivers have to pay taxes because they are quote unquote gainfully employed and such, right? But then also consider too, all the infringements I had just mentioned earlier, and more particularly regarding the general funding with the State Highway Fund and the Texas Mobility Fund. Remember, the vehicle registration monies, some of that does go towards the State Highway Fund, and then the driver's license and emissions inspection fees do go, at least in some part, to the Texas Mobility Fund. But remember, the majorities of those, as I explained earlier, are going to other things not related to the roads, and I already listed those. So those Uber drivers are actually financially supporting, against their will, because it is taxes. This is taxation, okay? It's not some, you know, membership fee. They are kind of supporting through taxation, you know, these different financial schemes that the Texas government has done and admit in their CAFRs then.
Yeah, I would say so.
So I guess maybe what I'm trying to get at is maybe, so it is a good example of competition, but it's not exactly a form of tax resistance now, is it?
No, I wouldn't.
I would assume that would also apply to anybody who may be listening that either is one of those drivers or is considering becoming a driver. I think there was something too. I think maybe you or somebody else mentioned about like the types of cars or the model years or something. There's a certain like minimum standard. I think that's worth mentioning.
Yeah, I was, you know, I've been looking for a job to like, you know, I was looking for a job to like, you know, work with my school schedule, and I was looking into Uber and Lyft, and Uber was 2005, year model of 2005 or newer, and Lyft was, I think, 2000 and up. So if you have a vehicle that's, you know, older than those years, then you can't drive for them. So.
And in some sense, as far as like a business model, that makes sense. But for people who might be scraping by or people who are trying to dig themselves out, if either poverty or worse, they're like indebted with like bad credit card debt, whether due to their own fault or not. Yeah, unless you can, you know, either finance a new car with a loan or maybe borrow it from a Yank friend or something. The options become quite limited real quickly. And even then, there's still the tax resistance question. And that is something I did want to get to. If I remember correctly, I think it was something actually that was brought up regarding, I think there was like two different methods, I think. One was the vegetable oil conversion, which is usually what the environmentalists and other people promote. But there was also another method, wasn't there too, Shane?
This is something, so down at around our property in southern Illinois, it's obviously like it's a farm, a lot of farmers, it's good farmland in Illinois. A lot of farmers such as Howard Buffett, you know, Warren Buffett's son, Howard Buffett owns a lot of land down there in southern Illinois. And there is a certain type of diesel or gas that is sold to farmers untaxed. So if you have that sort of access, you could save quite a bit of money. But I do know here in Illinois, they put a dye in it. So if they have any reason to believe that, you know, you may not be paying your taxes on your gas, if you get caught with it a couple of times, I'm pretty sure it'll completely negate. I think the second time is like $2,500. Like it's a lot of money. So if you do that and you don't get caught, then yeah, you're going to save quite a bit of money on your fuel.
How very counter-economic of you. regarding the veg oil conversion, I will concede that, you know, there's a little bit of a, I don't want to say barrier to entry, but there's a configuration, there's an installation that has to happen. And once you overcome that initial hurdle, that's the word I was looking for. Once you overcome that initial hurdle of actually installing the veg oil conversion, then as long as you can find sources of used vegetable oil, like usually like fast food joints and similar types of places that kind of produce that excess stuff that otherwise they throw away, then if you kind of, you know, contact those people, especially like the on-duty manager, for example, and ask, many of the environmentalists say that a lot of times either they'll sell it to you for a pittance or actually probably more commonly since they otherwise would throw it away. So it's almost a little bit like dumpster diving in some sense, like freeganism, right? Which I've also written about. Then a lot of times they'll actually just give it to you gratis, you know, for free. Just, hey, you know, take away our trash, you know, for whatever reason you want our trash, basically is kind of how they do it. They're disposing, there's a transfer of, well, not to get too technical, but in economic terms, it's actually a transfer of property rights too, except it's gratis, right? They don't charge you a price for it. In fact, in a lot of ways, you kind of help them out because then they don't have to take it to the dump, right? Instead, it just goes in your...
Indeed.
Right, but then, of course, there's some other costs, right? I mean, some of the environmentalists who do use veg oil converted cars will say things like, sometimes I smell like French fries. People tell me I smell like French fries when I come out of the... So just keep in mind, you may not want to take your prom date or go to the fine art exhibit in your tuxedo or nice ball ground, dress in the veg oil car. I'm just saying, if those claims are true, and I suspect they very well may be, just kind of keep that in mind. You may want to consider it more like a work truck or something, if you know what I mean. And then, of course, there's also the issue of, highway versus highway travel, like traveling like more than 100 miles, cross country trips versus just traveling your like normal commuting distances, and which for some people are longer than others. And there's a lot more material I would suggest people read up about that regarding veg oil conversion. But suffice it to say, man, the one problem with the veg oil conversions I've noticed is that you need a car that's a diesel engine. It has to be diesel. I remember talking to some of my environmentalist buddies from back in the day, and they said it has to be diesel. It will not work with your stereotypical standard unleaded gasoline car. Like, don't do it. You will ruin the carburetor. You will trash the pistons or whatever the other parts. I'm not an auto mechanic. Sorry, folks. I do have my limitations. I'm sorry. But basically, you'll ruin the engine is basically the short, long and short. And you'll end up with worse than a lemon because the car won't even work. So make sure it's diesel. And there's a lot of choices too. There's a lot of body types, a lot of makes and models. There's all sorts of information on the internet elsewhere for the more technical information. I'm simply mentioning it here that, well, consider, again, like we said at the very, very beginning about the whole direct taxes versus indirect taxes. Well, the indirect taxes, like the taxes on gasoline and all that, this would be a form of tax resistance where whether you use the method that Shane was kind of mentioning a moment ago, or you decide to kind of do the more veg oil conversion, these are different ways of trying to at least starve the state, which unfortunately the Uber method does not.
So these next couple that we're going to look at are kind of similar in a sense, perpetual traveling and seasteading. Or minimalist or minimal sailboating would be more like perpetual traveling than seasteading, I would say. But what kind of options do these provide in, resisting these infringements on right to travel?
Well, obviously, the perpetual travelers, I mean, these are the guys that go globetrotting, right? In fact, actually, I think it was an episode of your Direct Action series, I think, where you interviewed Pete Sisko.
Yep.
Yeah, and I don't, correct me if I'm wrong, and I'm trying to recall this right offhand, maybe you remember better than I do, but I don't think he was actually, like, in a car a lot of the time, I don't think.
No, from the cities he mentioned, they're pretty much in big cities and they walk everywhere. And I guess that something that came to my mind, too, like, even if you're a perpetual traveler and you do, like, want to get a car and drive, I'm sure other countries have driver's licensure requirements, too, so if all you have is a passport, I don't know if you could actually get a rental in a different country, like in the various, it obviously would differ from country to country, but just random country, for example, if they have a driver's licensure laws and you're a tourist, essentially, or you're staying there on a 90-day visa or something like that, you might not actually be able to rent a car if you don't have a driver's license there. So I don't know if, I don't know that for sure. I have never perpetual traveled. Maybe that'd be a question I should ask Pete Sisko, but that's something I just kind of.
Yeah, that's interesting. Let's table that for now, but kind of leave it as an open question, but at least as an option for further research and whatever else. But yeah, I think that kind of sailboating thing was also kind of arguably similar, although I don't know, to me it seems almost a little bit more attractive because at least you're not relying on like the airplanes or like the so-called public transportation of one kind or another, or walking everywhere, which granted is good for your cardiovascular health, but generally speaking your physical fitness, but in terms of efficiency and getting things done quickly and especially if you're hauling loads of heavy things, kind of start wishing you had an internal combustion engine nearby, right? The sailboating's interesting. Now help remind me, I think it was in a chapter of Vanu, The Search for Personal Freedom. Didn't Rayo say something about sailboating?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah, he definitely talked about, sailboating. Yeah, he for sure did. As you know, one way, your freedom of movement is something he focused on a lot. That was definitely something he covered.
Yeah, so yeah, that's rather interesting. So maybe a way of exercising one's right to travel, freedom of movement, would be maybe ditching the automobiles in favor of boats. Remember, most of the planet is water. It's like, what, 3/4 water or thereabouts, whatever the fraction is.
Yeah,
most of it's not even land, or actually less than that's even livable land, right, in terms of like agriculture and such. Most of it's water. So in terms of moving, your freedom of movement, as you prefer, around the, not, well, maybe not just this, the periphery of this particular continent, like the Atlantic side and the Pacific side, maybe even the Gulf of Mexico, but even just around the planet, most of it is water. So in terms of gaining a greater freedom of movement, maybe that's an option. I guess that too would be an open question too regarding, do you need a license to use a sailboat? Do you need to get it registered? I mean, I don't know. If you're going especially into international waters, do you need to have emissions inspections for your sailboat? I know I'm being a little bit facetious here, but as questions for further research, perhaps by other people want to pick up the ball and carry it forward, I would say that's one place to start from.
Yeah. And I know Rayo mentioned, he was mentioning, what do you call them? The trimarans, the type of boats. And he was talking about, you can get one for whatever price. And he said, it's best to go to this location because they don't make you like get it registered or anything when you can just like drive it off the lot, so to speak, or I don't know how
float
you put
it,
that
float,
in water
float
terms.
Or something. Float it
off the dock. it's a better way of putting it. But yeah, obviously that was, you know, back in like the 60s and 70s. So more research needs to be done on this subject or this particular, possible.
Yeah, so maybe automobiles are not all cracked up to be all that. Although, you know, there are, as just as a side note, I do know that there are people, especially on, I like calling it, kind of like how we call it fascist book, I like calling it idiot tube. I think you know which website I mean. There are people on idiot tube they call themselves like van dwellers, and it's almost like they're trying to emulate Rayo in some ways, but some of them mention that they get harassed by the cops a lot, and I don't think that happened with Rayo too much. I don't think back in the 60s and 70s.
Maybe he hasn't mentioned it in anything I've read, so I don't know.
And well, one thing I do know is that, you know, one of the, he's not doing this so much anymore, but like one of my colleagues, Alex Ansari, was living and he was doing the whole van dwelling thing. I guess you could call it van nomadism for like the better, like a year in change. Up until where he's now transitioned to off-grid homesteading, thankfully. He's now actually in a structure with a roof over his head, which is nice, so kudos to him. But yeah, I mean, like he was describing like practically, like, you know, sometimes some days were fine and then other times he would get harassed and such for different things. So I guess that's another option, again, a topic for, you know, perhaps another time for people to explore certain specific things, but again, I would assume, Shane, that even if somebody was to do the van nomadism thing here, and I think Rail complained about it back in the 60s too, the surf tags, I think was how he put it, right? You have to keep legal in or about the van. And it's like, yeah. So, I mean, that's, again, maybe a topic for another time, getting into that a little bit more deeply. Let's see. Well, remember earlier I mentioned the $55,000 deposit?
Oh, yeah, definitely.
Again, if... either that or the surety bond at this point, but let's say the $55,000 has arguably the least amount of red tape. Again, if you have the spare capital hidden under the couch cushions and you don't like the auto insurance companies, this is a way out for you. For everybody else who doesn't have a spare $55,000 under the sofa cushions, it almost begs the question, I mean, do we need to pursue that other thing, which is known variably as like financial independence or early retirement and so forth, before we can, you know, try and go for the $55,000 option? In fact, actually, hold on. Didn't you have, to refer to the Direct Action series, of course, again, I think it was Jake DeSillis, wasn't it, you had on?
Yep, that was correct. It was back in January of 2016 where we actually we had him on the show, and he provided a lot of valuable information. So just go to libertarianattack.com and use the little search bar and just type in Jake DeSillis or financial independence. You'll be able to find it very easily. And maybe you take his advice to heart and you find it to be a viable strategy. And you follow the instructions, and hey, maybe you can actually do the $55,000 deposit thing here, and you know, whenever you can.
Yeah, and just to be clear, the $55,000 thing, that is in Texas law. I want to stress that. I don't know what it is for the other 49 states of this otherwise highly overrated union. But that's what the law here says. So if you're Texan, it does apply. It is an option for everywhere else. I don't know. Check your local laws. Don't blame me if it's something else, if the reality is something else, or I should say the legality is something else, right?
Indeed.
You know, and in terms of going more broadly with the solutions and all that, I think some of those things we were mentioning, like the perpetual traveling and the sailboating and some other things, a lot of that, or even the tax resistance with the veg oil conversion and the thing you mentioned with the farmers, in some ways, a lot of that stuff are like lifestyle changes, right? You're making voluntary decisions. You're kind of, dare shall I say, maybe making yourself invulnerable to coercion as much as possible. So there mm-hmm. is that element of it, but not everybody's like that. There are people who they're the stereotypical activist types. They want to confront government agents, sometimes even on camera, because they want to cop block. They want to film government agents and make them accountable. And we've heard of this rhetoric. I think you've heard this rhetoric over the years and such. And one of the ways...
Too much.
I agree with you on that. So a lot of those folks will try different things. And I do want to take some degree of time here and at least cover this, because I think it's important, especially if people have kind of followed us all the way through here, because I think this is very, very important, because I do not want people becoming political prisoners. I think there are better ways to secure one's liberty. So what a lot of the right to travel activists historically, even in recent years, have really tried to do is, I guess you could call it pro se litigation. And this would essentially be, these are the guys who want to, I'll use the phrase because this is what's recognizable, though I disagree with the terminology, they want to fight the ticket. Ooh, fight the ticket sounds manly, doesn't it? I want to fight the ticket. Okay. That's what they want to do. They want to fight the ticket, quote unquote. But what does that actually mean in reality? Well, it means that, well, after the traffic stop, as I've explained earlier, they have and they're not arrested anymore, right? They have the written promise to appear. That's what the traffic ticket is. Well, they trundle on down to the court. And generally speaking, they say, you know, I'm not guilty and I want to litigate against this. I don't want to pay the ticket. I think it's unjust law or whatever. Maybe, hell, they'll even go for a jury nullification defense. You never know. But the problem, or not the problem, but, well, actually that too. The point is, they will go into the actual courtroom. They will actually see at least the judge and the prosecutor, and depending if they can get one, maybe even a jury trial, although most of the time they actually tend to be bench trials, meaning judge trials, where the judge actually hears prosecution defense and then makes his ruling, and then that's what's binding on you legally, because he's acting as an adjudicator at that point. Here's the problem. So you have like modern right to travel activists, guys, and there's many of them. But for example, I'll name two. You'll have modern right to travel activists like Viral Engel and David Krauss, who typically advocate that people ought to exercise their right to travel by litigating pro se in a government court once they get a traffic ticket. The idea here, and this is the strategic goal, so please listen up, everybody, because a lot of people don't get this, even though guys like Krauss and Engel do explain this very clearly in their work and such. The goal here is to plug or clog up the courts by making the costs of enforcement too high for the police and the courts. I'll say it again because this is important. The goal is to plug or clog up the courts by making the costs of enforcement too high for the police and the courts. Now that sounds fascinating, doesn't it? Just first impression.
Yeah, definitely.
The question is, does that make you more or less vulnerable to coercion?
Easy answer. You're inside the belly of the beast a lot if you continue to fight tickets. So, yeah, definitely more vulnerable.
Well, I would just say this. For anybody who bothered to go on a political field trip, I've done my circuits, you've done yours, and we've both written about our respective political field trip circuits, especially the ones to courthouses. Anybody who's even done that knows that there is a concentrated police presence at the courthouse. It is one of the most highly secured types of government buildings. Plus,
man, don't mention the scanners when you walk in.
Oh, they pat everybody down. They did it to me. I think they did it to you too. I think you said in your report too.
Well, I went through a metal detector, and if they want to, they can, you know, feel you.
Okay, all right, and you have to do it as a condition of entry. We all know that. For those of us who have practical experience, not this theoretical stuff. Practical experience with government.
And if you're a big advocate of, you know, self-defense, you always carry a firearm on you. Well, you're defenseless there, at least in that
so unless you want to go straight to jail. Yeah, because that's the reality of it. So for those of us who are practically familiar with government, because we are not keyboard warriors, we've actually know something in a practical experience, this is what happens. You're absolutely correct. And also one other thing too, when you're in that courtroom, you do not have free speech of any kind, because there's a little thing called contempt of court. You even mentioned this in your own articles and writings and such. So right, yeah. Now you have it from both the executive branch, the government police, and the judicial branch. When a judge says, oh, I don't like what you say, contempt of courts, you know, shut that, you know, this, I mean, why do you think you don't see families in there? I mean, children, I mean, contempt of courts. And they, I mean, I don't know, maybe that's happened somewhere where some kid got contempt of court. That would be one hell of a YouTube video, wouldn't it?
Wow.
I'm not certain. Maybe people should follow, maybe people should try and see, but the point is there's a reason courthouses are not happy places. There's a reason you don't take your kids there. You don't take your, try not to take your elderly people there or sick people or even your lovers and loved ones just more generally, even platonically, right? There's a reason these are not happy places. I mean, you're basically like one or two steps away from actually, you know, the actual jails and prisons, the government dungeons. Okay, yep. We're getting really close to the black heart, deep heart of the state. Of course, that's its own topic for another time, of course. The point here is that the pro se litigants say, go to court and challenge the traffic ticket, which is actually what's happening. That's a better, more accurate verb. They're challenging, they're litigating against the ticket. And it's like, okay, so even in order to make this happen, just methodologically speaking, take your preferences, take your biases, put it aside for a moment, just objectively look at this. Objectively, you actually have to go through, as you said a moment ago, Shane, you have to get patted down, you have to go through the security, and even then, you say something wrong, you act, you know, you look a weird, you know, you look off to the side a weird way, or they interpret it that way, your body language, hell, sometimes you don't even need to say anything. People have gotten in trouble literally for not taking off their baseball caps in court.
And also too, I mean, you mentioned the strategy, like if you win a couple of times and, you know, you're trying to clog up the system, so maybe you drive without a license plate on purpose and you just continue to get tickets. Well, once if that's successful a couple times in court, I mean, as with legal interstices and loopholes, the government's going to close on that. So this is something I would think that would have to be like consistently adapted to, updated or new laws altogether.
And remember too something else when I was reading the entirety of that, admittedly that short ruling regarding the Danny Murphy case. Remember, Danny Murphy didn't even challenge the constitutionality of the statutes he was charged with violating. And it was all that stuff. The driver, again, the list, the driver licensure, the vehicle registration, the emissions inspection, and the lack of, they were accusing him of lack of auto insurance, but the liability certification more broadly. And he didn't challenge constitutionality. Here's my question. How many of the modern pro se litigants are correcting for Danny Murphy's mistake and actually challenging constitutionality of whatever is on the traffic tickets? How many? Does anybody know?
Not sure.
Where's the transparency, my friends? Where's the transparency? These guys want you to risk your neck by going into these highly secured government buildings and trying to convince the lawyers, prosecutors, judges, etc., to convince the lawyers that they shouldn't hurt you using lawfare. Now, if that can work, can somebody at least bear their burden of proof and show it can work? Don't lecture me. That's happened in private conversations, by the way, Shane. I'm saying this for the first time publicly here. I've been lectured in private by some of these people who shall go otherwise unnamed that I'm bad, I'm wrong, I'm a defeatist was what one particular individual said to me not too long before this article came out, the last one, Extra Constitutional Number 7, that I'm a quote-unquote defeatist because I'm skeptical about the efficacy of pro se litigation, especially in the context of contesting traffic tickets. That's how bad this is. They're biased. They're like two steps away. I hate to say this, Shane, but they're like two steps away from being political crusaders.
That, well, gosh, yeah, that's definitely true.
All I'm saying is bear your burden of proof, show some successes, and then we'll revisit the issue. Heck, can these guys even make a jury nullification type win? And look, I'm skeptical about jury nullification, different topic for another time, but please, people, please just be objective. Where are the successes? I want to see it. Put it up on the internet. Brag about it, right? If we're going to be advocates of liberty and you can beat the lawyers at their own game, why not tell everybody about it? What's with the secrecy? What's with accusing me in private? And you know who you are, all but a handful of you, and others who support them. Why lecture me behind the scenes when we're having private conversations, but you're not willing to bear your burden of proof? I don't know, man, but I'm smelling disingenuous activism, unfortunately, at least to some degree. But hey, maybe I'm wrong. Prove me wrong.
And also,
that's all I'm saying.
And also, I mean, a lot of people don't have the, like, when they get pulled over and they get a traffic ticket, even if they're, like, principled, like, say they're an entrepreneur or something, they're busy, they don't have time for, you know, going to court and handling mm-hmm. a case. So that's also another aspect, too. I mean, that's a lot of time. You got to, like, you have to do a lot of research. You have to, you know, be pretty adept on the subject. And then you have to actually go and physically fight it in court, which, you know, it could be a quick one, could be a long one. Who the hell knows? I mean, those things kind of vary in their lengths, which is why they tell jurors that it could take a couple of days or you could be there for a month. They just don't know. So
there's also the court costs, too. So think about that, too, folks. I mean, that's another reason I'm not exactly jumping on the pro se litigation bandwagon, encouraging people to basically go contest the traffic tickets. Because how's your piggy bank looking these days, folks, since the 2008 banker bailouts? And I'm not being mean, I'm being realistic here. How's your piggy banks looking? Because if you have we were mentioning the $55,000 deposit thing, do you have like a spare thing underneath the couch cushions to that you can allocate for legal defenses? Even if you're going, now some of you may opt for a lawyer and pay him, that's more money on top of it. Others may opt for a public defender. And that, yet there are others that would go pro se because they're trying to keep their costs down or they think they can do a better job than lawyers can. Maybe that's true, maybe no, depends what individual we're talking about. I don't have any case studies to work with because it's all this secret, secret, secret bullshit. But they get mad at me in private, but they won't actually tell the public and brag in a good way and brag about their successes against the system in terms of this whole clogging up stuff. That they claim is we should do it. That's the other thing too they've always said. And it's not just the private conversations. It's also in the literature. It's in books. Some of which are actually in hyperlinked in the bullet pointed section of Extra Constitutional number 7, by the way. So there's even books that are coming out, even new ones, thankfully. And I'm glad, I want to be clear here, I'm glad the subject matter is getting out there. We need to be concerned about right to travel. Absolutely. No question. That's why we're making, that's why we're doing this podcast right here. But I don't want to encourage people to do foolish things that may very well make them political prisoners when it didn't have to be that way. And there are easier and more importantly, more effective ways to still achieve the same ends of exercising one's freedom of movement without having to unnecessarily and recklessly risk your neck and go straight to the government dungeons.
Okay, so we've got only a couple solutions left. The next one is civilly defiant freedom cells. Are they worth the risk?
Okay, so there's two different concepts here and they're being kind of merged together. So let me explain each one as briefly as I can and then I'll explain what the combo is. So there's the concept of a freedom cell. And this largely comes from John Bush and at least to some degree, Derek Brose, I believe it is. And I believe actually Derek Brose, I think you've had him on at least a few times to discuss a variety of things. And I think you mentioned freedom cells then too, I believe, in at least one of those.
Yep, it was near the end of the direct action series. I think in June or July, I lose track, guys. I'm sorry, there's so many broadcasts. But yeah, June or July, we interviewed Derek Brose on freedom cells. So just go to libertarianattack.com and again, search bar, best friend. Anything you want to find, just go use it. Just search for Freedom Cells or Derek Brose if you want all of the interviews we've done with Brose, which it's getting kind of extensive.
Right, and so just for purpose of reference, people can go check on that and learn all the details of Freedom Cells. So the other concept is something called civil defiance. There's another podcast series that I do kind of intermittently with, of course, Gary Hunt, and that's called Behind Enemy Lines. And I believe it was the latest or the last one we did, where he is birthing Gary's idea of civil defiance, which is kind of like an in-between step between civil disobedience and pretty much armed resistance for the most part, or at least monkey wrenching, right? Classically understood monkey wrenching, or at least something to that effect. So essentially, you know, what people would colloquially call standoffs would arguably be civil defiance. Although if you look at other examples, like during the last government shutdown, I think that was what, 2-3 years ago, something like that? The last government shutdown?
Man, I don't remember, I'm sorry.
That's fine, but basically during the last government shutdown under the Obama regime, just like Bush regime, right? Under the Obama regime, there was the shutdown of one of the World War II memorials, I believe is what it was. And there was such an outcry.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, Gary wrote about it at the time, too. There was such an outcry about that, that they there was a use of force, to be fair. There was a use of force. The veterans and just supporters and just family members or just other people who were there in D.C. Forcibly picked up the barricades, removed them, and accessed the memorial. And thankfully, nobody got hurt. Cops didn't democide anybody. They just, I don't know, I guess they were either on a coffee break or let them waltz in, or I don't know why they're, I'm not saying they should have, I'm just saying I don't know why they let them waltz in after removing the barricades, but thankfully, nobody got hurt. All I'm saying is that that could also be considered a form of civil defiance, even though no guns or firearms were used, but I think it's probably safe to say, based off of the case studies that Gary and I were working off of, and especially how he formulated the concept of civil defiance, which again is his idea, his descriptor and so forth, usually I think it would be more than fair to say that firearms are at least are usually holstered or, you know, slung on you. You know, you're not pointing it at anybody, right? That you're now getting into arm resistance at that point, even if you haven't, you know, squeezed the trigger yet. But generally speaking, if you're armed, and there's also, and it's set against the context of not bowing to, you know, the orders of you must disperse. This is this is not a peaceful assembly, even if you're all like, you know, barbecuing or something. So, you know, there are different examples. I think probably the most fair one would probably be Bundy Ranch back in April of 2014 too. So, yeah, you know, there's lots of different examples, and people can go listen to that at outpost-of-freedom.com/radio/BEL, and it should be there. But yeah, so there's these two different concepts, right? So the minarchist idea of civil defiance that Gary birthed, and then there's the more anarchic idea of freedom cells, which I think comes from Bush and Bros, at least in some sense. Okay, so the idea here, this is interesting. John Bush came out with a video, and I transcribed it, and it's hyperlinked into Extra Constitutional Number 7, which is about using freedom cells for right to travel activism. And what was interesting is that based off of John Bush's description, and not only did I transcribe it, but I also reread my transcription and re-listened to him to make sure I got the wording precise. But the impression that I got based off of the language John Bush used was that essentially, if you use freedom cells, if you already have one formed or you form one ahead of time, you can use it to commit civil defiance. And
should I real quick, like, just explain, please, what freedom cells are? Okay, so freedom cell, like 7 to 10 people, there's an ideal number, and now it's in the interview I did with Bros. Like 7 to 10 is the ideal number for a group. Any more than that, and it's there's some sort of reason for this, for like the ideal number is like 7 to 10 people. And I mean, it's essentially up to the group what you actually do. I mean, it could be a group of just like research, just like a research group. It could be a group that, you know, focuses on organic farming or community gardens, or it could be like the group could be involved in, you know, research, organic or community gardens. I don't know, agorism, or something like, self-defense and mutual defense. So this would, that'd be relevant in context with the freedom cells. And so it's 7 to 10 people doing whatever they decide that they want to do in their freedom cell, and obviously they can associate with other freedom cells in their area, but that's essentially kind of the idea. It's probably much like a security team, only there's a lot more
yeah,
you
know, the
room for accommodation to whatever,
right? So a freedom cell could work like the limited government notion of like a security team too, where it's more about just, you know, self-defense, mutual defense for like other individuals, and it's more underground, right? That kind of has to be arguably kind of like the French Maquis in some ways back during World War II, arguably. I would say this, though, the freedom cells are, of course, broader. It doesn't have to be that. It can be that. But you can also have other people be more like where it's kind of more like a retreat group for, you know, if the Schumer ever hits the proverbial rotary airfoil. There's that, yeah, too. You were mentioning more counter-economic activity and so forth.
And there is. I know when I was talking to Derek about this, there can be like an esoteric and an exoteric version. Like there could be like the esoteric and the exoteric version of your freedom cell. So there's things that'll be above ground, like you're trying to, you know, you might be trying to recruit some people. You might be like trying to, you know, combine efforts with other freedom cells, or, and you also have your, you know, your underground agorist type stuff. So it's kind of that duality.
I've heard about that too. I don't want to get too deeply into that here, other than just to say in passing, I kind of disagree with that. You know, it's kind of like pick whichever way you want to be, but I think mixing the two is not so good, at least in terms of security culture. But again, that's something that's debatable at a later time. The idea here, and the reason why the civilly defiant freedom cells are being mentioned here regarding right to travel, is simply this. John Bush's idea, as I understand it and transcribed it, was that, for example, if let's say a member of your freedom cell is subjected to a traffic stop, Bush's idea was something along these lines. You would have some sort of, not necessarily early warning system, but whether it's using a smartphone app or even a CB radio or whatever your communication means are, the person that's being coerced against in the traffic stop would alert the other members of the freedom cell, and they would quickly converge on the location. This is how it's supposed to work. Quickly converge on the location and, shall we say, make it very clear to the officer that they're not going to take their friend to jail today. And as Bush, more, and to paraphrase Bush, maybe some of them are armed, some of them are not, but they're there, and now what happens? And obviously he was being careful with his phrasing, as I am trying to be, but that's kind of the idea. So assuming that I'm understanding John Bush correctly, the question is, what's the efficacy here? What's the risk, and so forth? Now, having described it that way, what's the first thing you think of, Shane?
Well, I mentioned this to you whenever we were preparing for this, but like, you just consider the state and how they like to demonize any opposition, and oftentimes, you know, the public eats it up. They eat it up, and I guess the first thing that comes to mind for me is, you know, even they would presumably be free market anarchists. Like, if it was like a freedom cell with, like, you know, John Bush and Derek Rose, I mean, both great guys, you know, good people focusing on solutions. Even though they're those type of people, the state would still probably compare them to, you know, like white supremacist psychopaths and just kill them on sight. I don't think it's necessarily a good idea at all.
Well,
I really don't.
Let's make this a little bit more concrete for people. I mentioned Bundy Ranch a moment ago. Well, Bundy Ranch was an example of civil defiance actually working. But then, as you well know, because you remember this from last year, actually this month, a year ago, right?
I wish I could forget.
Yeah, the status turf war, or what people would more commonly think of as the Malheur fiasco up there in Oregon, where a bunch of guys were squatting at a bird cage. That was just, oh God, what a friggin' disaster. And so arguably that too would count as civil defiance, maybe not necessarily the entirety of it, but definitely for certain from the time Finnegum was put 6 feet under to the time when David Lee Fry as the last man out surrendered, definitely that latter portion in February, yeah. For certain, that was real civil defiance at that point. Some people think it was the entirety of it. That's debatable, I guess, maybe. I personally think it was that latter part. Once the roundup and people and the cuffs were getting slapped on everybody else and so forth, and people were scattering. But that was more, correct me if I'm wrong, Shane, but I don't know, was that a success? Honestly.
I would say no.
Yeah.
I mean that's just like practical, like the strategy. I mean that I don't think they really achieved any of their goals. There's some attention being drawn to the public lands thing. Or there was attention being drawn to that, and I guess there's some other things stemming from that we don't really need to get into in this podcast. But I mean, the stated goals, did they succeed what they were trying to do? No, as far as I remember. I think what are their names? The Hammonds, they're still rotting away in jail. What the hell is his name? Steve Hammond. Mm-hmm. Stephen Hammond. He's celebrating his I think it's yesterday or today. He's celebrating his 74th birthday in jail, prison, geez. Whatever. So, I would say that was one of their stated goals. The other is, you know, the public lands issue, and neither of them have been resolved. So, I would say no, it was a complete failure on
those. Yeah, Mallard, you're right. The political prisoners are still in there. Actually, there's more, right? Which is ironic. And Mallard is still under the control of the federal government, is it not? Because remember, the other kind of other goal that came after the Hammonds, or in addition to the Hammonds, was we want to turn it over to the Oregon government in Harney County. Right. That was said multiple times by the Citizens for Constitutional Freedom defendants, multiple times. And did that happen? I mean, we're like a year from that point.
Well, that's not the focus anymore.
Oh, yeah. But, notice how that works. Nobody's actually being consistent about anything.
Yeah, it's definitely frustrating. I guess maybe, I don't know. I really don't know if there's ever been, other than maybe, I don't know if you know Molotov cocktails by the syndicalist, the supposed anarcho-communist, which is ridiculous. But I don't know if that would be considered a civil defiance. And even if it was, I mean, I don't know, are corporations dissolved? Is the corporate welfare gone? Have they succeeded in their goals? Hell no. So even if that would be considered civil defiance, like from a supposed anarchist group, but like a difference in ideology, that's still a failure. I mean, obviously it would be interesting to have some case studies, you know, it wouldn't be good either, because it's almost guaranteed going to be some people dead or some people in prison.
Yeah.
I mean, difference in ideology, like a free market anarchist group doing something like this, I don't know. Maybe it's different. I mean, you remember in Malheur, all of the association with, like, meeting with the sheriffs and the FBI agents and all of that. I don't know. I don't know. I guess maybe it would be a little different with the different ideology, the different set of principles, but I don't know. It's all speculation at this point.
Yeah, and again, like Bundy Ranch was even admitted by the infamous SPLC as a great victory for the Patriot movement at that time. But then again, doesn't the events of Malheur kind of render that nunc pro tunc in some ways? Because remember, Clive and Bundy, I don't want to get too deeply into this, but remember, Clive and Bundy was picked up at the Portland, or right around the Portland airport, because he was en route. And then some idiot on Facebook basically mentioned, hey, he's en route. And then they just swooped in and grabbed him, you know, put the cuffs on and such. So it's just kind of like, okay, so let's get more back to the point. So if John Bush, if somebody actually carried out his idea, and let's say they did it perfectly, everything went well. And now we're at the point, we're at the side. So here's the scenario. We're at the side of the road. We have, let's say it's one freedom cell. So what is it? Seven, eight people?
Just seven people, yeah.
And let's say it's one cop. Doesn't matter, municipal, state highway trooper, sheriff's deputy, doesn't matter. It's not a fed, okay? Because feds don't do traffic stops generally. Okay, now what? What do you think the officer is going to do realistically? Let's run through this. You're the officer, what do you do?
The officer's probably going to put his hand on his gun, okay. I would imagine. You know, I'm guessing he's going to put his hand on his gun. He's also going to pick another hand to his radio. Right. And he's going to call for backup.
Amazing how that works. Keep going.
I know, He'll probably walk back to his car and detain the individual. Probably just sit there and wait for backup. Backup will get there. We'll call it in and say, holy shit, like, I'm surrounded. There's like seven people here. A couple of them have guns. I think three or four of them have guns. This is not a good situation. Give me some guys here. Probably send like, 10 cop cars, that's a big thing happening, typically they're just doing traffic stops and things. So they'll probably send like, everyone that's out, and you'll have, I don't know, maybe 5-10 squad cars, 10-15 people. And, I don't know, from there, that's where it kind of, gets interesting and potentially.
Well, of course. And actually here, let's spend like maybe one more minute on this, but let's see, let's say one of the guys in the freedom cell, not the original guy who got pulled over, but one of the guys who showed up, let's say he notices or they otherwise get wind, or maybe just as a precautionary measure, kind of assume, hey, the cops are calling their backup. Let's call our backup. So let's say they're in contact with another freedom cell. You see where is going. Okay.
Yeah. And then you have like a massive like goddamn turf war and standoff.
And to be fair, I'm not making fun of John Bush. I have utmost respect for the man, but I do think ideas do need to be tested, whether a priori as we're doing right now, or perhaps at some point in the future, some people might be willing to put their necks on the line and do it a posteriori, if you know what I mean, actually doing it. So just going on a priori. So let's say the one guy who just showed up, he calls up and say, hey, let's call up another freedom cell, and they show up. Right. And this is consistent with how Bros has explained the concept of freedom cells. Right. OK. Mm-hmm. So they call up another. So they call up another guy, or they call up another cell. OK. And those guys show up. Imagine you're the officer. You notice another batch of 7 to 8 people show up, and you know your guys are on the way. You're the officer. What do you do from that point? Let's assume you're the original officer on the scene. You already called the backup. You show up. Now, what do you do?
Man, I obviously, like, if there's some armor on the other side, I mean, obviously it is possible that, there could be one of the officers, or maybe a majority of the officers, like with a wild hair trigger finger, and they might,
sure,
shoot quickly. Or, I mean, you could have this little standoff. I guess maybe if the cops, didn't want to get into an armed conflict, Like, I don't know, the Freedom Cells or members of Freedom Cell could say, like, yeah, you're not taking him away. We're going, he's going to drive away. We're going to, we're going to get him out of here. And like, let's say it does kind of just de-escalate like that, which that's not typically, you know, the behavior of police mm-hmm. officers, but, like, let's say even then, I mean, then you got all these people on watch lists, probably criminal charges filed against them. You've got, the original guy, probably fleeing mm-hmm. police. I mean, I just don't see any good outcome.
Yeah, and see, and look at, and just maybe another 20 seconds on this or so. But yes, you can see the point here is that now, obviously, we're doing this a priori, and maybe we're making a mistake here, just for the listeners. Maybe there is a mistake in our reasoning, and maybe you should seriously think about this stuff too. But knowing what we know about the government police, why wouldn't they escalate the use of force to the point where, if not necessarily shots are fired, maybe they, say, take a truncheon, break somebody's arm. No deaths, but somebody's hurt. Now what? What do you do? Okay, there's that.
Yeah, and I think another thing to mention here, and I think this is something that you brought up. I mean, if like civilly defiant freedom cells, if this is something that you're considering, you gotta also ask the question. This is you know, covered under Brandenburg v. Ohio, but unless you're ready to kill government agents in self defense, then you really shouldn't even be considering this idea whatsoever.
Yeah, that's the long and short of it. I mean, if folks are wanting to go that far, and I don't think that I'm exaggerating this, and I don't think this is a I certainly don't mean this as a joke or anything, and I do respect Mr. John Bush, but I think it's also time to be realistic and not just sound like utilitarians, but more importantly, Shane, we're looking at events in history, even recent history. We're talking like within the past 5 years. So we're not talking about George W. Bush and his crazy time period, you know, against, you know, Muslims and having the TSA manhandle Coptic Christians. We're talking about things that have happened within the past 5 years. Okay, this isn't, I mean, a lot of this is even recent history. So people in many ways have been experimenting with something like what John Bush is talking about, to be fair, not precise, but close to it. And it's been mainly the Patriot movement, ironically. And what have been the results?
Yeah. Nothing positive as far as the stated goals go.
So I think that's been adequately covered personally.
Yep, I definitely agree. So, interesting discussion there if you guys enjoyed that. But the last one, this is the one I'm most in favor of, and it's the ultimate question to, you know, trap an anarchist. The ultimate question. If you ask them this question, game over, anarchism is defeated. Kyle, road privatization, you know, government abolition. You know, who will build the roads? Well, private companies, just as they do now. So, so let's talk a little bit about that as another solution.
Sure. So, obviously, I did a book report on Dr. Walter Block's book on privatizing the roads, which, of course, as is with all the most important stuff on the bullet-pointed list in Extra Constitutional number 7, here's the long and short of it. I'm definitely in favor of road privatization, without question. And at that point, it's not really so much a matter of politics or even philosophy, although there is, I think, an argumentation ethics justification for it, of course, private property ethic and all that. I think it's more an issue of economics. And I think when people argue against road privatization, and you know who you are, shall be, you know, the guilty shall go unnamed. The problem is that they're denying the private property ethic, at least to some degree, which means they're doing it at all. And there's also the issue, too, which they hop, skip, jump over. Earlier when I was mentioning about the vehicle registration, about the possible legal interstice, and I went into some detail on that regarding the definitions of words. And the long and short of it is, if you're on a public highway, you got to get the vehicle registered. It's a the automobile becomes a vehicle, and you got to get registered. You have to follow the law in the TTC, okay? That's as best as I can figure it. But remember, it's specifically exempted, and it said, you know, the public highways are not private roads and so forth. So if there's that case for road privatization, mm-hmm. it's, if anything, not only is it a kind of a viable economic thing, but it's also technically a legal interstice as well, at least in Texas. I don't know about anywhere else, but at least in Texas it is. So I think that's rather quite profound. However, like I mentioned in the concluding article of the series, there does need to be some capital investment required, and to be fair, the people who like the public roads for whatever strange reason really do make somewhat of a good point in that it costs quite a bit of money, doesn't it, to actually build a road.
Yeah, I'm sure it's not cheap.
And I would also then say, well, that, okay, I'm not ignoring that. However, I would say that maybe the prices are perhaps super inflated or overinflated, mainly because of the...
And efficiency and the lack of ability to, like, I guess the you know, when it comes to socialism and, you know, the roads handled by the central planning governments, I mean, there is either, you know, some impact on, you know, economic calculations. So I'm sure those prices could
Right. I mean, anybody who understands catalactics understands this, right? Where I am making a kind of a catalactic or praxeological statement here, at least in some sense, for those of you who understand the Austrian School of Economics, in that I think the reason why the road prices are and why it's so expensive to build a road is because the prices, those market signals, the prices are distorted like all hell. And if there was actual real competition, if the roads were not centrally planned, then I think the prices would come down quite a bit. I'm not saying it would necessarily be really cheap. I'm just simply saying it wouldn't be to the tune of multiple millions of dollars for even one like mile stretch of road. Even a crappy two lane.
And I don't think it's even possible now to calculate like how much each individual pays like in taxes for the roads, because as you kind of mentioned with Texas specifically, I mean, that's all that money is going in so many different directions. I don't think you can even.
It's a minority. Remember, it's a minority. The majority of it's going to other stuff like the interest on bonds and so forth that what I've already described, right? It's going to things not roads.
Exactly. So, I mean, I do think the prices would come down quite a bit, you know, competition and all that good stuff. But yeah, just even in this paradigm we're in today with, you know, the centrally planned roads, I don't even think it's possible to calculate how much it even costs per person. And if we were able to do that, I think it would be pretty exponential and people could actually see, you know, holy shit, this is how much you're actually paying for the roads. Okay.
Yeah, and one thing also I want to mention in passing here before we get to kind of the other related thing is quite simply this. In private conversations with different constitutionalists, they're pretty much all uniform. It wasn't just one particular one. So for those of them who happen to listen to this, it wasn't just one particular individual or another. They were pretty much all unified when I was speaking to them different times, different places, and even some conversations from even years ago when I was just kind of more curious about the topic. I didn't know much about it. And they were like really staunch about public roads has to be taxpayer funded and all that because it's in the Constitution. You know, and it's like, well, first of all, no, there's the issue about the federal constitution, as I've already explained. And then even then, you know, just because there's public roads that are constitutionally enumerated in the Texas Constitution, yes. However, that does not prohibit or outlaw the existence of private roads. And again, the definition for public highway in that one TTC chapter specifically exempted private roads from being considered legally as public highways. So in other words, there's kind of a distinguishing out, very much like when I wrote about that primer on homeschooling shame. Hell, you probably interviewed me about that one too, if memory serves. Remember what I said too, just as a parallel example, just because public schools are constitutionally enumerated in the Texas Constitution, federal government wasn't involved in that one either, by the way, everybody. So listen to that episode if you're curious more about that. But just because the Texas Constitution enumerated public schools does not therefore mean private schools, private education, or as was the case in the infamous Leaper case, which is now the basis for the legal remedy of withdrawal from public school, grabbing your kid out and doing it legally right here in Texas. The whole basis in the Leaper case was that, well, just because public schools are constitutionally enumerated does not therefore mean that private education and so forth was outlawed or banned. The judges even admitted it pre-existed the damn government. And it said it's been carried through, it's never been banned, it's never been outlawed, but the friggin' Texas Education Agency or Administration, its fourth branch again, right? Oh, those bureaucrats keep popping up, don't they? The TEA was prosecuting these families, and the head guy, his name is Gary Leaper, or at least that was the name of the case they decided to use for one of the parents. You know, they were persecuting these parents, it got litigated all the way up. And so just to say this very simply, just like how with public schools, the constitutional enumeration of them did not outlaw the private sector version of education, similarly, the constitutional enumeration of public roads did not outlaw the private roads. And we know how successful the homeschooling movement has been. I'm a product of it. I am literally a product of the free market, literally. I have never held a government job in my life, and I don't intend to, God willing. So, you know, if I'm a successful product of private education and affordable private education too, which is what homeschooling is, then what possible justification is there to demonize private roads? I'm sorry. I mean, it's almost like the Patriots are trying to kind of in a kind of circuitous way almost justify, probably without realizing it, like the Soviet Union's bread lines. Without government to bake, you know, without government, who would bake the bread? Without government, who would build the roads? Hell, at that point, without slavery, who would pick the cotton? I know they mean well, but, or at least some of them do, but my goodness, please look at your logical fallacies and maybe, you know, consider that maybe you're just a little bit, you know, economically illiterate and just own up to that. Be honest. Or learn economics and maybe change your mind. Up to you.
Indeed. Yeah. Yeah, definitely. Definitely. So anything else on road privatization? I think we've kind of, we've discussed, I mean, that's something often discussed. And for my audience, I don't think that needs to be emphasized much further.
Yeah, well, road privatization is an expression of the private property ethic vis-a-vis our argumentation ethics. People can use argumentation ethics and kind of reason that out on their own time. But I think that the result is obvious personally. Self-evident, as the founders would say.
Indeed. So I've got one other note here. Article 1, Section 2 of the Texas Constitution. I want.
Oh, this is my favorite one. Yeah. Okay.
And with the best.
Well, right? It's a legal interstice too. That's what makes it, you know, double and triple wonderful in some ways. Okay. So people are familiar with the different Texas secessionists of various stripes and flavors, right? There were some guys back in the 90s. There are guys right now. I mean, they're called the Texas Nationalist Movement. And they very clearly say they want the political autonomy of Texas, sovereignty in the typical political context, to secede from the admittedly highly overrated Union, and otherwise, you know, go her own way, as some of them put it. Okay, well, what's the legal basis for that? Again, take your preferences, take your biases, take your whatever, put it aside for a moment, just objectively, like, look at the laws. What is the legal basis for secession? There's been different arguments over the years. Some people point to treaties, I think one guy suggested the Treaty of Hidalgo at one point. There's all sorts of treaties up the wazoo. I would say, to keep this very simple, I don't think we even have to look at treaties. And to be perfectly annoying, one more time, let's look at the Texas Constitution. And like you said, exactly right, with a correct citation, Article 1, Section 2. This is right in the Texas Bill of Rights, actually. So remember, Section 29 also comes into play about all laws contrary to anything in this Bill of Rights are null and void, basically. Remember that? So this applies to Section 2 as well, because it's in this Bill of Rights, which is simply this. To paraphrase, it is up to the good people of Texas to decide whether or not to abolish this government. I'm going to say that again, and I want to explain this just a little bit, because I think it's important for people to understand what exactly the hell is going on here. Article 1, Section 2, to paraphrase, says that it is the prerogative of the good people of Texas, Texans, whether or not to abolish the government here. Not the feds, not the United Nations, not all these NGOs or IGOs, the intergovernmental organizations, not all of this weird crap you always hear about in the news cycle. This is about the Texas government. Okay? Everybody understand where this is going. And yes, it's true that it also has other phrases, or excuse me, verbs in there about like reform and alter and some other things. It says also abolish. There's choices here. There's different paths. And so it is legal to say that is the prerogative of the good people of Texas to make the decision as to whether or not to abolish the government here. That is what it says legally. It's in the Constitution. Now, if you think about it, I can't find any similar clause in the federal Constitution. Can you, Shane?
Unfortunately, I don't think it's.
Patriot Movement will often refer to the Declaration of Independence. You know, leading us invariably into absolute despotism is the right of the people to alter or abolish it, right? But
Declaration of Independence, yes, but the federal constitution,
yeah, right? Knew. And there's a distinction there. So there's also kind of an interesting question there regarding the federal government, whether the Declaration of Independence is considered the law or not. Because remember, the whole point of the Patriot Movement is to restore the Constitution. Constitution doesn't say a damn word. I can't find a clause. Maybe someone can, but you know, I did a I did that five-part series, actually, with Gary Hunt on the Constitution. I think you mirrored that on the LUA site, I think.
Indeed.
Right.
Indeed.
And so, and he and I, it was a mini-series. We went line by line through that Constitution. So I'd like to think I'm at least a little bit knowledgeable about it. And I don't remember any abolishment clauses, but there is one in the Texas Constitution to abolish the Texas government. Now, I'm not saying whether that's practical, especially in terms of things regarding like the federal military bases, right? There's a lot of those different bases here. People are familiar with quite a bit of them. So believe me, I don't want to turn Texas into a federal enclave or a federal territory like some backwards place like Puerto Rico. No offense to the Puerto Ricans, but those guys are in a tough spot. I'm just saying. I mean, unless the perpetual traveler type people or expatriates can figure out a reason why a federal territory is better than a state government. I mean, you know, please come forward with that if you haven't already. But as for me, I don't know, man, federal territory almost sounds worse, at least in some sense.
Yeah.
In terms of like shades of gray, in terms of tyranny. But in terms of what the law says, Article 1, Section 2 does says abolish. So government abolition for Texas of the Texas state government is a legal interstice. And here's the connection to road privatization. The infringements against the right to travel, the driver licensure, the vehicle registration, the emissions inspections, the liability certification, including but not limited to the auto insurance, the traffic stops and the general funding. The question is, are the political crusaders in a position to fix any of that stuff? And if not, if I've been right this entire time, which I assume I am, but maybe I'm wrong, who knows, then would government abolition practically, not as a matter of law, but practically, would that be on the table? Would Texans, as far as a, let's call it a cultural ethos, would they get behind government abolition so we can enjoy our right to travel without, as Rayo put it, being forced to wear surf tags?
Mm-hmm.
There's also one other thing, too, and I think I mentioned this in passing. I'll repeat it here. Remember, there was the issue about in the definition for public highway. It was that other item about, I'm just doing this from memory. It was about the police power and all that. Now, if I'm right in assuming that may have been referring to things like eminent domain, we get into a little bit of a problem, don't we? If my assumption is correct, would it be entirely crazy if, for example, with the government still around, if there was a successful company, or shall we say, let's call it an industry of companies, who actually were successful, to borrow Dr. Block's term, road entrepreneurs, right here in Texas. Why not? Hell, might as well be here rather than, why not here, right? To be the forefront of what some consider a second American revolution, or the second Texan revolution, because we had our revolution 1835 already. The Americans didn't really help out on that one, but then again, it wasn't their issue here, at least historically speaking. What I'm trying to say is this. If the road entrepreneurs were successful enough with the government still around to grow a network of roads and let's say buy back, you know, remember the whole gun buyback thing? Let's buy back the roads. Let's say it was possible, right? It's all voluntary action anyway. It's completely, it's transactional. It's free market, laissez-faire and all that. Okay. Let's hypothetically reason this out a priori. They basically are successful. They grow and let's just say Amarillo area and they grow and grow the network. Let's say 50 mile diameter, grow private road network and it grow or larger. And it grows to the point, or shall I say expands to the point, where you don't actually have to get on the public highways unless you're like leaving the general region, right? Of like, let's say Amarillo or North Texas, okay? Mm-hmm. Is it entirely crazy to assume that the vested special interests that control the Texas government and especially the legislature right here in Austin, is it entirely crazy to assume that they wouldn't try to do some underhanded nastiness or even above ground openly would try to do something like use the eminent domain power of the Texas government to forcibly seize those private roads, either in whole or in part.
Or just rewrite the law to where it includes those roads too. I mean, you can't put anything past these fucking
right, exactly. Limits. So that's why when it comes to road privatization, as a matter of strategy, not as a matter of end goal or anything like that, because I do agree with that, as a matter of strategy, I don't know if it's necessarily wise to not just push for road privatization, which is what we're doing. It's advocacy, which we're free to do, free speech and all that. But I'm saying more as like a practical effort of guys actually like investing money in the entrepreneurs, people smarter than I am, actually making this work. I don't know if it's necessarily wise to do that now with the government still around, because all they have to do is...
It's a lot of risk and a lot of potential, like a high potential of losing that money.
I'm not saying it couldn't work. Remember, again, to go back to the Vanu book, Rayo did mention something about like free isles or free ports and things along those lines. And like I said earlier, yep. Houston is already almost kind of there, although they're trying to turn it into more of a city-state type government, but whatever. The point here is this. I don't know if it's necessarily wise a matter of strategy for the road entrepreneurs to try and privatize the roads before the government is abolished. So if I'm correct in that, what that would mean strategically is that it might be better to hold off on road privatization until after the government is abolished, because of vested special interests, plus the fact that, you know, the Texan people, good as they are in many of their respects, and I'm talking culturally here, okay, I'm not talking about the government, as they are good, and I've lived here for over a decade, okay, I like to think I know a little bit about Texas culture. Hell, there was even a course in college I took, which was literally called Texas Culture by the history department of my alma mater. But yeah, I mean, I like to think I know a little bit about Texas culture, and as good as they are in many of their respects, I don't think enough of them appreciate just how serious the right to travel infringements really are.
All right. So very, very good. Very good. A good point to kind of end on. So let's begin to close this out. I guess what do you think is pertinent for the listeners to take away from this discussion?
I think it's really kind of pertinent that there is such a thing as real systematic grievances that actually affect them and also affect individually and directly, as well as a lot of people. I mean, again, to mention the FHA statistics one more time, tens of millions of Texans are affected by what I've described here tonight, at least in some length. This is not to even mention what other people may do in their own follow-up research regarding Americans outside of Texas, with how many more people are affected by laws and such that are similar to these. And so, you know, instead of worrying about the latest sensationalistic news headline of something that may or may not be tyrannical, that may or may not have happened, maybe instead, like, look at your own life, you know, from the time you wake up to the time you go to bed, and ask, you know, how much does government infringe on your life? And as I'm saying here tonight, I'm suggesting that these right to travel infringements, again, one more time, the driver licensure, the vehicle registration, the emissions inspections, the liability certifications, such as the automobile insurance precisely, the traffic stops and the general funding are all violations of your freedom of movement in different ways, to be sure. And that those are things that you should be focused on, at least in the sense of learning about them, and then trying to discover, and then should you decide to agree with me that this is something that does affect your life and you want to change your life for the better without asking for permission to do so, that maybe you should look into some forms of direct action, such as what was mentioned just a little bit ago, and maybe see, well, maybe you want to prefer that form of direct action, but not that one. Maybe you want to try the sailboat thing or maybe something else. It's up to you. But I'm just suggesting that maybe you should focus on reality instead of some myths and superstitions you've been fed your whole life about roads particularly.
Indeed. And definitely well said. Well said. Kyle, thanks so much for joining me. This has been a 4-hour recording bonanza, which is a lot of great information. But anyways, thanks so much for, 4 hours of your time, you know, going through all of these things that you found out. I definitely appreciate it. And, I know the listeners will as well. You can find Kyle's blog at thelastbastille.com. And again, Bastille is spelled BASTILLE, thelastbastille.com. Definitely check the show notes for all of the things that we referenced. I've been taking notes this entire time of what needs to go in there. Definitely follow up on all of his research. And again, Kyle at thelastbastille.com is his email address. If you decide to do any follow-up research or if you want to disagree with him, call him an asshole, whatever it is, I'm sure he'd appreciate any emails that that he could get. So thanks so much, Kyle, for
thank you for having me on.
And there you have it. That concludes Kyle Rearden and I's discussion on his Right to Travel series. I hope you found it informative yet valuable. On a more positive note, I know I'm getting sick of seeing Mr. Trump's goofy-ass fucking hairdo, and I'm sure some of you are too. It may seem like a problem without a solution, but that's where you're wrong. I present to you the most badass Google Chrome plugin ever developed called Make America Kittens Again. That's right, Make America Kittens Again, M-A-K-A. Well, okay, maybe you block Origin and Privacy Badger, maybe more important since they are for privacy, but nonetheless, this one is a must-have if seeing the faces of those who falsely imagine themselves to be our rulers infuriates you. This plugin was developed by Tom Royal, and even better, it is open source. So you can also add your own kitten images if you so desire. Or if you're a dog person, fuck you, then you can upload pictures of dogs. There's just so much potential.